Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. My name is Kendra Cook. I'll be your host this evening, and you'll have to excuse me for my coughing, like I'm sure a lot of you are at home. I'm getting over a nasty cold here. Well, welcome to our first show of the new year. And if you're joining us live on the first Tuesday of January 2014, please remember that this is a call-in show, and you are welcome to give us a call here at the BCTV studios. The phone number here is 610-378-0426. And I will give you that number again later on in the show for our very popular car quiz that we always do. Wheels Along the Road is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, which is Pennsylvania's Transportation History Museum. And at the museum, we have dozens of vehicles on display, everything from horse-drawn carriages and wagons up to cars and trucks, even some bicycles and motorcycles. We even have a 1938 diner, which local residents will recognize as being part of Fagley's Family Restaurant, and we also have a 1921 Sunoco gas station, so we have lots to offer at the Boyertown Museum. If you'd like to contact the museum, you can do so in a number of different ways. You can give us a call at 610-367-2090, or you can drop us an email at mail@boyertownmuseum.org. And feel free also to visit our website, www.boyertownmuseum.org. Museum is located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, PA, and we're open Tuesday through Sunday, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. Two quick announcements about things going on at the museum right now. Our current exhibit is the Boyertown car scene. And on display, we have four cars and plenty of memorabilia that have history with Boyertown car clubs of the 50s and 60s. Three beautiful Fords are on display, two of them modified 32 Fords. And we also have a 57 Chevy Bel Air. So please join us at the museum and check out that exhibit. It runs till the end of this month, so it's not up for too much longer. My other announcement, if you remember, we talked back in November about the diner and the opening of the Sunoco station. We had a great event at the museum where we served pie and coffee in the diner at 1938 prices. 5 cent coffee, 25 cent pie. I think actually all of our panelists were there that day. And they can tell you it was very successful. We had a lot of people. And we're going to do it again. And we have the date picked out. It's going to be Saturday, March 22nd. And I know last time we had it from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. I don't know exactly the hours yet for March 22nd. I should know that by next month, but I figured I'd let you know the date at least tonight so you can mark that on your calendars. And we hope to see you there. If you were there last time, you're welcome, of course, to come again. If you couldn't make it last time, I can assure you it was a really great time. Everyone had such a blast and delicious food, so we hope you can make it this time. Well, I'm joined this evening by our regular panelists, Dan Olsen and Mike Yanessa. And our special guest is a regular face to most of you, I'm sure, Sam Fiorani. Thanks for joining us. And I promise they're not coughing anything like I am, so you won't have to endure that when they talk. So with that, I'm going to let Dan take it. Dan, what can you tell us this evening?
Oh, I can tell you a lot of stuff. So hopefully you'll get that cold taken care of.
I hope so. The cold air today did not help, I can tell you that.
Sound terrible. Anyway, so Kendra has a cold, It is like 6 degrees outside. But, you know, I'm getting ready for racing season. And those of you who know me, I love racing, car racing, that is. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. And we're going to start off early 60s. We're going to be talking about Fords. And, Sam, if you could show the first picture there. And you're going to be seeing, oh, boy, that's the second one now. There you go. Okay. That's a 1961 Ford Galaxy, and it's a hard top there, and nice car. And look at that sleek roof on it. And if you go to the next picture now, okay, that's the equivalent of it. Very squared off roof in the back there. That was the style of all the closed Fords that year. It was that Thunderbird look, that style of roof and such. That 1962 Ford that you're looking at caused some problems at high speeds. High speeds meaning places like Daytona Speedway. Had a 406 cubic inch engine in. It was not strong enough to make up for the difference in roof from the year before to that. They estimated they lost 3 miles an hour speed. You know, per lap, and there was a lot of turbulence also, so they were not a real stable car on the track. Again, we're talking that style there. Jacques Pacino, who was Ford's racing guru back then, said in 1961 we had a fastback. Again, that was the red car we just saw, called the Starliner. Then in 1962 we had a sedan that looked like two cigar boxes. We needed a car with a different roof because this was not aerodynamic. Competition at the time, the Pontiac, Chevys, and Plymouths. Pontiacs and Chevys were pretty aerodynamic. They had the big engines. They had the bubble top roofs. The Plymouths, they were downsized cars. They had a larger engine, so that kind of compensated for them, too, and some powerful cars. So Fords were having some problems. Their solution, if you could show the next picture now, they had a bolted-on, slope-back Starliner roof. The roof is from a 1961 Ford. It was, well, based on a 61 Ford. It was a fiberglass roof, and they just put it on top of the convertible there, and that's what you had. As you can see, this is like a factory picture. And to make things more feasible, Ford took a bunch of publicity photos. You see one there. They printed literature, had advertisements for a removable hardtop. They called it an alternative top for more weather protection. Actually, they just wanted to go racing with it. They had some of those Starlift, that's what that's called, the Starlift. They had some Starlift-equipped convertibles in different Ford showrooms around racetracks down south also. Now, the racing strategy here was kind of focused on Holman Moody. And for those of you who don't know, Holman Moody was a race car factory down in Charlotte, North Carolina. Ford funneled a lot of things right into them. So if you wanted a Ford factory car, probably came through Holman Moody. They built two true convertibles for the Rebel 300 at Darlington. The reason they were convertibles, they were still allowed to run the convertibles for that one race. But Ford built two of those convertibles, and they figured after that race, they'll just stick these roofs on, and then they were going to take them to Charlotte to run the 600, the World 600 in Charlotte. What happened is the Charlotte race got rained out a couple times, and it was rescheduled, and then and June 10th, or wait, excuse me, let me back up here. The Charlotte race, they were ready to race them, but Ford said no because you need a 45-day period in time from approval by NASCAR until you could race it. And that 45 days did not come until after Charlotte. So what they did, they ended up getting two regular Ford sedans and racing them. Meanwhile, it was Atlanta that was rained out twice, and then on June 10th, they actually had the race down in Atlanta. And if you could show the next picture, please. Okay, There it shows one of these racing cars. This is actually a recreation of it, and it has an actual 61 Ford roof on it. And you see kind of this goofy little triangular panel where the back window would be. Well, that was one of the problems there. If you look at the window line, the side window line of the roof there, as you can see it on that car, that would be the 62 Ford. Well, as on 61, they had a larger side window. So to compensate for it, they had to put that panel in there. This was a Freddie Lorenzen car, again, a recreation of it. And this was taken a few years ago down south somewhere. And I believe a gentleman in Texas has it now. So anyway, that car, actually two of them showed up down in Atlanta for the Atlanta 500, and they were eligible to race because they went beyond that 45-day period that NASCAR said you needed to get approved. However, Norris Frile, NASCAR's chief inspector, had some problems there. He was saying the tops have plastic side windows. Remember we saw that little goofy side window piece in there? Well, he demanded that they be removed, and you'll see a picture in a moment here, and you'll see it without that little panel in there. And then he also realized the windows could not be rolled up into the top like they should have been. Also, the cars, this is kind of strange, and I had to read this over about three times before I figured out what was going on. Remember, these cars without these tops were raced down at the Rebel 300 down in Darlington as convertibles. They did not need the X members in the frames. Those X members were for convertibles, but they were allowed to remove them. But now they were racing the car as a hardtop. NASCAR demanded that they put the X members back in, which is kind of a strange way of going thing. So anyway, they ran around, they found X members off of some 62 Ford convertibles, and they welded them in, and they were all set, ready to go racing at Atlanta. The inspector, Frile, also then consulted with NASCAR's president, Bill France, whether or not they'd still be allowed to race. So there was still a lot of back and forth negotiations going on. And I have a quote here from Motor Trend of 1962. It says, "The decision came before the race. John Holman and Ralph Moody were told that the cars would be allowed to run this one time, but until NASCAR was satisfied that the bolt-on tops were sufficiently available and proper notice was given of a new model, they would be ineligible." So as far as we know, those two tops on their two cars down there in Atlanta were the only two that they had. Now, I mentioned they would be allowed to run this one time. Well, that meant they were allowed to run because Holman Moody, which was the big Ford race team, didn't have any other cars. So now you go to one of these NASCAR races and they got you know, two, three cars to choose from. So here it was, this blatant, I don't think you could call it a rules infraction, but it was something that pushed that envelope a lot. And I cannot imagine something like that happening today. For those of you who follow racing, any little infraction, it could be a 16th of an inch. There's fines for the driver, for the race team, for the owner, everybody. Suspension, double secret probations, all sorts of things are going on. Whereas here they were allowed to race because they didn't have any other cars. So then they were told that the cars would not be allowed to run the NASCAR race again. If you could show the next picture, please. And that's the car at the race, and you can see the slope back roof on it, and show the next one also. And I think I skipped one in there, but that's okay. So they actually raced them at down there in Atlanta, and there was two drivers, Fred Lorenzen in the 28, and then there was Nelson Stacy was in another car. They got the okay to run about one day before the race, they didn't really have a chance to practice. And part of the practice is getting the tires kind of scuffed in ready for the race. Lorenzen only scuffed in one set of tires. Stacy did not scuff in any. He had no practice. He ended up dropping out of the race rather quickly, and I think he finished, like 30th or something, way back. Well, all this commotion going on, Henry Ford II made a statement 2 days after the race is over. He was the president of something called the AMA, which was the Automobile Manufacturers Association. And somewhere there was a ban, not somewhere, 1957, there was a ban of that was made by the AMA to not use racing advertisements to sell their cars. And part of that was the factories would not be directly involved with racing. However, Pontiac was doing it, you know, through the back door. They were sending parts out. Chevy was, the Chryslers with the Petties. Also Ford. This roof was a big thing of the Ford factory being involved in it. But Henry Ford finally got upset with it, and he says, that's it. We're quitting this, and we're gonna get back into racing up front. We're not going to be hiding anything. So that started in 1962, something called Ford's Total Performance, where they took all different kinds of racing, whether it was at Le Mans, stock car racing, drag racing, whatever, and they sunk all kinds of money into them, making Total Performance of Ford's vehicle. Very successful program there. So that ended up doing that, you know, being up front with the racing. Couple weeks later, Chrysler said the same thing. GM never said anything. They never said, okay, we're going to go racing up front. However, Pontiacs were still winning. They were still getting their back door parts instead of the front door. Same with Chevys, too. So soon after that, now that Ford is in this Total Performance thing, they start experimenting with the Starlift top, and they also came out with a 483 cubic inch engine. Bill France got wind of that and said, okay, we're going to limit the engines to 7 liter, which is 428 cubic inch. And that's what it was for a long time until I think the 70s when they went to a small block engine. Now, one of the places, if you could show that same picture you had just a few minutes ago, that it shows the Ford, there you go, that's at Bonneville. That's what they took it with this, this big engine in, the 483 cubic inch engine. Had 500 horsepower. They went on a 5 mile oval and they tested them. I don't know how long, okay, average speed for 500 miles was 164 miles an hour. They broke 46 national, international records with Fred Lorenzen, Ralph Moody, and Don White, another race driver there. Apparently, they learned a lot from the design of that fastback there to come up with the design of the 1963 Ford, which is the next picture, please. There you go. It's a 63 Ford. It's squared off a little bit, but it's a lot more slope than the original 62 Ford. So that's pretty much the story of the Starlift Ford from 1962. And, you know, you pay attention to NASCAR today, and you come up with a lot of technical things that they do and keep them in line, but back then they really pushed that envelope, and I don't think the rule book was as tight as it is now. The race. You probably want to know who won the race. Okay. And show the last picture, please. And that's the two guys, that Freddie Lorenzen and the 28 on the outside and the Starlift Ford. And inside is Banjo Matthews, and I don't know if that's 02 or 22, depending if you look at the door or the roof there. Mm-hmm. They had a battle lap after lap after lap. And there's a lot of rain delays. They had three cautions for 61 laps because of rain. That's a lot of caution laps. So anyway, those guys had a side-by-side, bumper-to-bumper race for 140 laps. Those guys raced against each other. Well, guess what? Another rainstorm came and it was shortened. They went only 219 laps out of, I'm trying to think how many they were supposed to be. So they went little over 300 miles at 101 miles an hour. The winner was Fred Lorenzen. So that was interesting. It was an illegal car. He was allowed to race that one time, and he ended up winning. And I thought that was pretty neat, with Banjo Matthews for second. And that's it. Okay.
Thank you, Dan. I like that last photo, action photo.
Oh, action.
It's great. That's I love it.
And oh, by the way, one last thing for you race fans out there. Motorsports show down at Oaks this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Okay, now you can talk.
Thank you. Thanks, Dan. Mike.
Yes.
Thanks for coming tonight. Thank you. Despite the cold. What have you got for us this evening?
Well, we're going to talk a little bit about 1959. In some of the other shows, I guess it was about a year ago or so, I was lucky enough to get a 59 Impala, and I did a little bit of a series there of bringing it back to life. So I always tell people this, and I'm one, when I go to shows, I try to find literature for that car. So I was lucky enough to go and get a 59 assembly manual, and I got a 59 accessory guide, which is really cool. It shows you all the options and stuff, and of course, a 59 brochure that you would have picked up at the dealership. Really cool pictures in here. I can just show you a few. But I recommend anyone that has a car, when you go to the flea market, go through the literature aisles. It's not terribly expensive, depending on condition and rarity, $10, $15, and you can pick up some really cool stuff, as well as hot rod books, Motor Trend magazines, all those types of magazines from those years. You could really learn a lot about your car. So I'm going to talk a little bit about 1959, and the first thing I'm going to talk about is I was lucky enough to pick up these set of books at a flea market, which is 1, 2, 3, and 4 of the Turbo Glide transmission. There's a lot of people don't know what the Turbo Glide is. It is a very unique transmission. It's a very complicated transmission. You heard of the Power Glide, I'm sure, or the Turbo Hydromatic 350 or 400. Well, Turbo Glide came out in, I believe it was 58, and they were behind a lot of the big block cars, the 348 cars, and most of them did not hold up. I was lucky enough to have two cars. I had a 61 Impala with a Turbo Glide, and the 59 has a Turbo Glide. The unique part about this transmission, and I want to clear something up, some people say they're two speeds, some people say they're three speeds. If you look at an old Chevy and you see the indicator, it'll say GR and drive, where a Power Glide will say like one and two or low and drive. The Turbo Glide's always said GR, which means grade retard. So you would think it's a two speed, which would be grade retard or drive. But they're not. They're actually a three-speed, and they don't shift. If you ever rode in one, they just glide between gears. The reason being, I have one picture I could show you from this little book, is there's not there's gears in it, but it doesn't shift between gears. If you can look at this, let me see now. My fingers are this picture over here. If you can zoom in on that, you'll see the ratios of first gear is 267 to 1. I'm sorry, it's this one. Over here, see it? 267 to 1, second gear is 1.6 to 1, and then third gear is 1 to 1. But it's three torque converters. And so when you pull out the giant torque converter up front, just like any other automatic, and then it would go to the other torque converter, and then the last torque converter. So there is no shift, there is no boom, boom. You don't feel that noise. It just kind of like a centrifugal clutch on a snowmobile or a mini bike. And very unique, very interesting. I say the reason these two survived that I own is because they were behind 283s. The Impala I have only has 34,000 on it, and the other one has about 90,000 miles on it. But they're little motors. So the Turbo Glide, you don't hear much of them. They're very complicated transmission to work on, but they were a little bit ahead of their time. I don't know why they didn't continue with them or develop them, but they didn't. They went back to the two-speed Paraglide, and then later on in the mid-60s, they came up with the Turbo Hydromatic three-speed, which was a shifting transmission. So again, at the flea market, I paid $2 a piece for these books. I think I gave him $6 for all four of them. Something really cool. And I also have a Turbo Glide service manual. So I haven't needed it yet, but if I do, it's interesting. It's good reading material. I recommend anyone out there with an old car to, you know, look in the literature aisle at Carlisle or Hershey or whatever. You can pick up some really cool stuff. So at GM Carlisle, I was lucky enough to find this book. And it's the story of Chevrolet from 1911 to 1959. I've never seen another one. It's really an interesting book, the history of Chevrolet. And the 59 part of it is what I'm going to talk about a little bit about tonight. It's amazing in 1959, the infrastructure we had in the automotive industry that you don't realize until you pick up a book like this. I think I paid $8 for it. For example, there was 32 plants in 1959. We had manufacturing plants in Tarrytown, New York, Atlanta, Georgia, Flint, Michigan, Bloomfield, New Jersey, Oakland, California, Ypsilanti, Michigan, Norwood, Ohio, Kansas City, Missouri, Oakland, California, Los Angeles, California, Janesville, Wisconsin, St. Louis, Missouri, and Baltimore. A total of 13. Assembly plants. That's where the cars were built. So we had 13 plants across the country building 1959 Chevy cars, trucks, and Corvette. Remember, there was only one model, 59 Chevy. It was the same front end for the El Camino, the station wagon, the Impala, the Bel Air. So you had one car, and you had Corvette and Chevy trucks. But 13 plants. When you talk about Chevrolet or you talk about Ford or any of them, you always think Detroit or you think Michigan. Yeah, a lot of it was headquarters around Michigan, but they had plants across the country. Think of all the people that were employed at these different manufacturing plants across the country. Also, General Motors had manufacturing plants, and they had a total of 15 of them. Indianapolis, Indiana, Toledo, Ohio, Livona, Michigan. Actually, they had two in Toledo, Ohio, and Livona, Michigan, three in Saginaw, Michigan, two in Flint, Michigan, Norwood, Ohio, Tonawanda, New York, Bay City, Michigan, Buffalo, New York, Cleveland, Ohio, Muncie, Indiana, Detroit, Michigan. Total of 32 manufacturing plants and assembly plants. Now, the manufacturing plants were just what it says. They manufactured parts for the new car. I know a lot of you have heard of Tonawanda, New York. That's where the engines were built. And General Motors owned glass companies, bumper companies, electrical, Delco Remy. They owned a lot of manufacturing plants that supplied parts for Chevrolet, Pontiac, Buick, Cadillac, all across the country. It's not like that anymore. You know, they outsource a lot of things. They buy parts from other manufacturers. And I got to keep saying this was 1959 because I was so fascinated by the mass of this all across the country that Chevrolet, you know, had a really big, or General Motors, not Chevrolet, I keep saying that, had unbelievable manufacturing process. So, in my particular car that I talked about was a 1959 Impala. The motor was built in Tonawanda, New York. The casting date on the motor is January 4th. Now, these motors were built in Tonawanda. They were put together in Tonawanda. And they weren't dynoed, they were ran on an engine stand, okay? So get this now, 1959 again. They cast it on January 4th, they assembled it, pistons, camshaft, heads, they ran it, and it was delivered to Baltimore, Maryland, because that's where my car was built, and it was delivered to Baltimore, Maryland, and my car was delivered on January 31st. Now think about that. That's a three-week period. It went from raw metal to a running engine to Baltimore, Maryland, and it was at the dealership and delivered January 31st. That's 1959. That's no CAD. That's no cell phones, no computers. The trucks that they drove were the old, Chevrolet or GMC trucks with no air ride, no air conditioning, no GPS, and it just amazes me. And, in 1959, we had a really strong automotive system in this country that isn't really there today. If you ordered a new car today, what would it take you? 3 weeks? Well, they were delivering them in 3 weeks back then, 54 years ago, with a lot less technology that we have today. So it really is amazing. And again, this little book that I picked up at the flea market, there's an overall view of the Michigan plant, that road that goes right through the middle of it. It's unbelievable. And I'm going to leaf through this and show you some other pictures, because the assembly line and stuff in 1959, you'll notice one thing that we probably don't have today. Look at all the rears in that one picture and all the people. Today, I think if you look at the pictures of the assembly plants, you'd see a bunch of robots and a few guys standing around. Where these pictures, it's nothing but people working together, jobs, and quality. They were very big on quality. It says it right here in this book. A new Chevrolet in 1959, I keep saying that, rolled off the assembly line one every hour. And that's, like I say, it's almost unbelievable that we're talking back in these primitive times as we remember them. But right here is a picture of it. It said this white Impala here in the center started in assembly line. And 1 hour later, the gasoline and oil was added, and it was ran and driven off. Every car got driven. Every car got tested by a human, by a person. And it's really something. Like I said, this little book has showed me that, we really did have an amazing car business in 1959. Now, it's not the same, of course. But back then, it was really industrial revolution, or what I guess you would call it. A couple other things about the 59. Back then, a good car. My car I've never tested, but they say a V8 car with 195 horsepower, I believe, don't quote me on that, got 20 miles to the gallon on the highway, probably about 16, 18 in the city. Again, 54 years ago, no computers, no oxygen sensors, no Kelly converters, no variable cam timing, and we were getting that kind of gas mileage out of a car that was full-sized V8 powered. Not so sure we really came that far in all these years today. I mean, today we're not doing that much better with a lot more pieces, a lot more stuff to break. Amazing thing about the 1959 full-size Chevrolet, it weighs 3,600 pounds. I can't believe that, but it's true. My Camaro big block weighs 3,600 pounds. A lot of new cars today weigh that or more. The overall length of the car is 17 feet and a few inches, where the overall length of a Camaro is 16 feet. So if you'd look at this car, you'd think it's some big, heavy, primitive, antiquated engineering, and really it wasn't. It was light, it got good gas mileage, it was aerodynamic. Another fallacy, you always heard about the 59s, that they stopped making the fins because they became airborne. That was proven false. In, I believe, 2009, they rented a wind tunnel in Detroit, and it's actually at 100-plus miles an hour. The wing configuration put downforce down on the back end of the car, where I know everybody has heard that story that the cop cars were getting air under the wings at high speeds. That's why they stopped making that body style. That's not true. According to, it's on the internet, it's 2009, somebody rented a wind tunnel and took a 59 Chevy and proved it wrong. So, just unbelievable. Again, going back to the original part of my story is buy literature. When you see them at flea markets, if you have a car, look around. I looked around and found this by accident. I do it with all my cars. I have, quite a bit, and that's how I learn, and it's really neat. It's really neat reading. This book has really enlightened me on how far advanced we were in 1959. So that's about all I have for tonight, Kendra.
Thanks, Mike. That is a neat way of looking at it.
Yep.
It was interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
At this time, we're going to take a quick break and hear a message from BCTV.
You're watching Wheels Along the Road on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other related stories, go to www.bctv.org. Program underwriting is a valuable source of revenue for bctv.org. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Welcome back to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. And I'm going to welcome back to the studio regular panelist, Sam Fiorani. Hi, Sam. Thanks for coming.
Thanks.
And I see that you're doing another segment in your lemons. I'm very excited. So go ahead.
Thank you. I like to bring these stories of lemons around. And in my normal job, I follow the production of current cars and around the world. And so I stumbled on a car, and I wanted to build a whole story around this particular car that I found. But this is another story of lemons. If you want to bring up the slides, please. I'm calling this one Global Oddballs. And I really like odd cars, and these cars are among my favorite of pieced together cars from around the world. The cars just seem a little different and yet familiar at the same time. For our first car, I've got a question for the panel. What kind of car is this?
A cyber.
It is a cyber,
How
yes.
How was that?
Sounds good.
You should be a detective.
You could.
I don't know. What kind of car is that, Dan?
I don't know.
This is the Volga Cyber,
built
in Russia by Gaz. Like I said, it's a little different and a little familiar at the same time. There aren't any Volga Cybers in the United States, yet a number of Americans drive a car just like this. Here's the side view of the car so you can get a little better perspective. You can see the short nose, the round wheel arches, and the cab forward design that all point towards
Chrysler.
In fact, it is related to the Chrysler Sebring and the Dodge Stratus from about a decade ago. After the Sebring and Stratus ended production in 2006, Chrysler sold the tooling to Gaz for about $150 million, and Chrysler continued to supply four-cylinder engines to the Russians. But production of the Cyber ended after 2010 with approximately 9,000 cars built. But back in North America, what happens if you combine the roominess of an AMC Concorde with the sportiness of an AMC Spirit and you build this car in Mexico? You'd get the Vam Lerma. With the hatchback of a Spirit grafted onto the rear of the Concorde sedan or the two-door, the Mexican company Vam had its own unique product. Power came from a VAM 4.6 liter, 282 cubic inch inline six, mated to a Chrysler Torque Flight automatic transmission. The Lerma only lasted from 81 to 83 when Renault took over the failing company. This is one of my favorites just because it's you don't see these in the States, and apparently they're fairly rare in Mexico as well. But they're still found on the streets in Mexico today. Renault was also part of the history of the next car, but a bit further south of the border. In Argentina, IKA Renault changed the tooling of an existing model to create this attractive coupe. Actually, there was a whole lineup of these cars called the Torino, not to be confused with the American Ford model of the same name. The IKA Torino was a modified version of the Rambler American. IKA stood for Industrious Kaiser Argentina, because after Kaiser ended production of cars in the United States, they continued in South America. Production of the IKA Torino started in 1966. IKA extended the wheelbase of the Rambler, the 64 Rambler American, by an inch and changed the front end and rear end designs, giving it a little more European flair to the style. Under the hood of the Torino, they replaced the AMC engine with a Kaiser Jeep 230 cubic inch Tornado overhead cam six-cylinder. A 3-liter version was also available. By 1970, Renault had gained control of IKA, which eventually became part of Renault Argentina. By the early 80s, Renault's own models were more popular than the Torino, and its long production run ended after 16 years. For the next car, we need to go back to 1976, when the Iranian automaker Saipa started producing the Renault 5, known in the U.S. as the Le Car. Even after production of the first generation R5 ended in France in 1985, this little car continued to be built in Iran by Saipa and Pars Khodro. Renault stopped providing parts and support for the Iranian car in the late 1990s, so Saipa was forced to find a replacement. Since they had the tooling for the body, but not a chassis, they decided to simply find a new chassis for the almost 30-year-old car. This is the Saipa PK. Aside from the fender flares, the most telling exterior difference between the old Renault and the new PK is the shift from 3 lug nuts per wheel to 4. Instead of the longitudinally mounted Renault engine, the PK was powered by a Kia Pride engine and shared its chassis. In the U.S., we knew this car as the 85 to 91 Ford Festiva. In Iran, however, the car was adapted for many uses. In addition to the PK, there was a Saipa Pride 5-door, the 4-door version, this one known as the Saipa 141, a wagon version known as the Nassim, and even a pickup version. Saipa produced the PK from 2002 to 2007. This tiny car on a larger car's chassis is equal parts awkward and interesting, and only something that could be produced in a country like Iran. These are just some of the world's oddest cars, and we haven't even started talking about copycat cars and trucks found in countries like China, like the 108-horsepower JAC 4R3, that looks an awful, awful lot like a Ford F-150. Mm. Or this BMW X5 knockoff called the Shangwan CEO. Or even the Yema SQJ 6451, which has more than a hint of Subaru Forester in it. Perhaps I could do another show on just Chinese knockoffs, but these are the cars I brought for you today.
Trip around the world.
Oh, I have a question.
Sure.
You're talking about the Torino there. What was the years of that again?
66 to 81 or 82.
Okay. Mm. And you mentioned it had that six-cylinder Kaiser.
Engine.
Yeah. What years did that start being made? I think that goes back further.
Well, the overhead cam, a few years earlier, but
just a few years.
Yes.
Okay.
But it's based on the older block into the 50s.
Okay.
Mm.
All right.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Mm. Thank you. Next time, we'll work on the China thing. All right, well, now it's time for Car Quiz. And last month, we weren't able to fit one into the show, so we've got some time tonight, which is great. The number here again at the studio is 610-378-0426. All right, Dan?
What?
What's our first? Well, don't tell us the first car, but...
Okay, there it is.
There we go.
That's a Hershey, isn't it?
You got it. Parked across the street. Which is one of the few places you still see grass at Hershey. So let me see what I can tell. There was that model you see there, the two-door, 39,845 were made. If that gives you any hint out there in viewer land. I like that car there because normally you don't see them with that trim level. You usually see the fancier ones. And so that's kind of a little breath of fresh air there with the two-toning with the beige and the white. And I think that's why I took that.
How about the white walls? Are they correct?
I'm thinking no.
I think they're too skinny.
Okay, we have a home viewer. Hi there, home viewer.
Yes, Dan. Would that happen to be a 57 Ford?
Absolutely. What model?
Is it a custom line?
No, it is a Fairlane.
Oh, Fairlane, okay. Fairlane.
Yeah. So what makes you, how did you know that was a 57 Ford?
My pop had a 57 Ford Fairlane 500 four-door hardtop.
Okay. So any special things you remember about that car, like it was a cool car, or it was just a car you and your sister fought in all the time?
Two sisters.
Oh, that's worse.
I was, was outnumbered. As soon as you see the headlights, I knew it popped up. It was a 57 Ford. It was a 58. They had the double headlights.
Correct. Yep.
I have a very good show, Dan. Really enjoy everything.
All right. Thank you.
You're quite welcome. Bye-bye.
The Custom that year ran on a different wheelbase.
I believe you were correct, yeah.
Same front end, though.
Much the same styling.
It was
a shorter wheelbase on the Custom. And
that, I think, is the midline. So you had the Fairlane 500, I think, and then the Fairlane, and then Custom.
And Custom 300.
Yeah. Okay, confusing. Yeah, but they had all those different kinds, but again, they just used that same car body, which goes back to the 59 Chevy that you were talking about, Mike. They had different things, but pretty much all the same.
Aside from the
Corvette and the Thunderbird, that happened until about 60.
Yeah.
Okay, if you could show the next picture, please. This is a little more difficult. And it's difficult, too. Name the location, Sam.
Radnor Hunt Club.
No. Never been there. Now, this is a AACA spring meet down near Cumberland, Maryland, a few years ago. I believe that's where it is. And behind me is a nice lake. So I had a thunderstorm that day. Let's see. This is a four-door sedan. There was over 19,000 of total production for that car of that year. Options on this for $33. You got two bumpers, one in the front, one in the back. $3.75. You got a right-hand sun visor. You know, we're so used to visors on both sides now. Back then, I guess the more expensive cars had on both sides, but back then only one side there. Came with, you could have a choice of two engines. You had a 213 cubic inch six cylinder or a 340 cubic inch eight cylinder. Eight cylinder is 87 horsepower. Very close, Mike.
Am I close?
Close, but no cigar. That has non-skid balloon tires on that.
Wooden wheels?
Wooden wheels. Yep.
Yeah, they're gorgeous.
Yeah, I like that. So,
trying to make up the hood around that.
What's interesting about this, and this is sort of a roundabout hint, I was at a place where they had motors that were, or engines that were built in the 1800s that were used for power, for pumping water, pumping oil and stuff at oil wells and water wells. And they had some pumps there made by the same guy who started this company here. So I don't think he was making those engines, those big engines, when he was making cars, but it goes back. No.
You even stumped the panel.
It's a GM.
Yep. Oh, I got part right.
Mike's over here guessing.
I'm trying to guess.
He got a couple, but it's not, no.
Is the year correct?
The year's right on, yep.
Okay, I got the right year, but the wrong models. Mm-hmm.
It's not a Saturn, so I'll throw that in there. So
the other one that Sam had, the name was right on the front. I got that one first try.
Yep. Well, I'm going to tell you, this is a 32 Oldsmobile. So that's a pretty nice looking car. I like the color of it. You see a lot of darker cars back then. As I say that, I'm looking at a green car, the one next to it's red, and I see a beige one in the background. So that's that. Yep. If you could show the next picture, it's a little newer here. A little newer. Let's see. What can I tell you about this? Got a choice of two different engines on this. You got a 91 cubic inch engine. Actually, it was a 1622 cubic centimeter engine, which is a four cylinder on this thing. And no, you didn't have a choice. That was the only one. I'm sorry. 90 horsepower, top speed 105 miles an hour, which is probably like a rocket in a little car like that.
Depending on the year, it was push rod or overhead cam.
Okay. Last year for that model, it was replaced by the next one, next year, of course. Factory recommended bolt-on steel disc wheels. But it was cool to have wire wheels, so most of the ones you see have wire wheels, including this one. That center lock knockoff wire wheels, it's a $100 option on those cars. Back in 19... Four-wheel disc brakes with the wire wheels. Road speed tires was a $250 option, the tires with the wire wheels and four-wheel disc brakes. Another option on this was the tonneau cover, which is $35. This does not have it. Well, luggage maybe it rack. Does, but they have
luggage rack, I guess. Would
luggage
be option,
rack, yep.
Right? Mm-hmm. It's got that.
And we're talking about the speed, 105 miles an hour, 0 to 60 in like 12 seconds. And they had a little phrase, a little advertising thing that they had back then. It was called Power to Overtake with Safety.
Ooh, we have a guess.
We have a guess. Right. Okay, yeah. Guess. What is that car?
I believe that's an old MGA.
Correct. You know what the year is by any chance?
If I had to take a guess, I'd say about 1962.
Oh, absolutely. Ooh. Right on. Mm. Yep. It's a 1600 MGA Mark II. So
well, I had when I was in high school, my best friend owned one of those, and the thing that I remember about it was that instead of having one 12-volt battery, it had two 6-volt batteries, which were located behind the seats.
Wow.
No, I didn't know that.
Okay, I'm sure you had a lot of fun in high school with a sporty car like that.
Yeah, we did. We did. There's a lot of good memories.
Did you get in trouble? No, you don't have to tell me if you got in trouble. But I know how high school kids could be, especially in a neat little sporty car like that. So, Okay, well, thanks for calling.
Okay, you bet.
Yep.
I'll take the car behind it, too.
Yeah, I figured you would like that. Kendra, do we have time for one more?
We've got 5 minutes, so let's try.
Okay, one more. There we go. Location?
Hershey.
Car corral. With a pink Thunderbird in the background.
And a DeLorean.
Yeah, yep. First year for that body style. Give you a hint, it was a Victoria. That was the body style, I guess. Flathead engine is another little hint. You know, you always hear flatheads being used with these cars. 239 cubic inch, 100 horsepower. Cost you $1,925 if you wanted one of them. You had three transmissions if you wanted. You had a three-speed manual. Optional transmission for $92 was a three-speed manual with automatic overdrive. And $159 option, here's another hint, was a two-speed Ford-O-Matic. Mm. Is that a good hint?
That was good.
Good one.
Good one. Big.
Still doesn't help me with a year, though.
Oh, come on.
I recognize the back end, but the front end.
Yep. Home viewer, yes.
Oh, here we are. Dan, that's 49 Ford, am I correct?
No, you aren't correct.
And the Thunderbird, I think, is a 55.
Okay, I believe that's a 57 Thunderbird there.
Oh, okay.
Okay, but try another guess for the one in the front there. You said 49, you're off by 2 years, so give it another guess.
51?
Really good, yep, that's
really?
A 51. Yeah, the way you can tell that... is you got the two little pods in the front, whereas the 49 and 50 has a one pod
right.
in the grill.
Oh,
and also the
yeah.
hubcaps are a little different. Right. But yeah, that's a hard top first year for it.
Okay, well, I'm 90% Ford man. And I never owned a 49, but I had a 52, I had a 56, and I had Fords all my life. So.
Okay, well, good. You're consistent. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have another home viewer. Another home viewer, sir?
Yes, we have another home viewer.
Yes.
Okay, hi. This is Dave. Okay, you've already identified this car as a 51 Ford. It's the Victoria.
Yep.
That was the first year that Ford came out with the hard top.
Yes.
That's it.
Yeah, did you have one or know of one?
Well, actually, yeah, I did have one for a little while.
Oh, really?
And before I junked it, I cut the top off of it.
Oh, no.
Hoping to sell the top, but never sold it.
How about that?
But anyway, yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling, then.
All right. Thank you. Have a good night.
Okay,
all right.
Thanks.
God bless
you again.
Well,
okay.
Great. And now, here we are, the end of
yep.
the show. Thank you, everyone at home, for joining us this evening at Wheels Along the Road. And I'd like to thank Dan, Mike, and Sam for being here tonight.
Thanks for having us.
Providing great material, as always. And until February, we will see you all then and have a warm and safe
warm.
Month in the meantime.